Hi again, everyone. Chris Tisdell here again. In this presentation, I'm going to continue my series of videos on complex numbers. Now, in previous presentations, I talked about the complex conjugate of a complex number and the modulus of a complex number. And in this video, I'm going to bring those ideas together through an example. So let me share my screen with you and we can get started, okay? So here's the idea, and I've already filled out a couple of lines here. Suppose z's a complex number with z not being equal to the imaginary unit. If the modulus of z is 1, then show the real part of this quotient is 0. Okay, so this is what we, under these assumptions, this is what we're trying to prove. Now, we're not usually when I type these things out, I put this curly R in. Some people, and indeed when I write it out by hand, I put the RE for the real part. Okay, so the way we're going to do this is going to use properties of the conjugate and the modulus. Okay, so let's just remind ourselves of what these things are. The conjugate, say if I've got z is a plus bi, the conjugate is just a minus bi and denoted by z bar. And basically, if you have a point in the complex plane, then to get the conjugate, you reflect the point in the horizontal real axis. And here are some properties here. You know, the sum and difference of the conjugate of sums and differences are the sums and differences of the conjugates, and same with products, and same with quotients. That we're going to use that today, and these two here. And if you take the complex number and add its conjugate and divide by 2, then you get the real part of the complex number. Okay, so that's conjugates. And then there was a previous video on the modulus or magnitude or length, if you like, and this is all the properties. And in particular, you can relate the a complex number and its conjugate with the square of the length or the modulus. Okay, all right, so let's get back to the problem. I've just put in a couple of early steps here. I'm going to let W be this quotient here, just to simplify things, and we're going to apply the properties of the conjugate and the modulus, and in particular we're going to start with this thing here, but with Z and Z bar replaced with W. Okay, so the real part of W is half of W plus its conjugate. Okay, so if, and I want to show that this is all zero. Okay, so if I go back to this form up here, what I'm going to do is take the conjugate and see if I can simplify. Okay, so putting these brackets in here means I'm taking the conjugate of this quotient. Okay, so now I know that if I take the conjugate of a quotient, it's the quotient of the conjugate. So I can start trying to simplify already. So I can kind of move those conjugates inside. This is division here. Yeah? Okay, all right, so I've got a quotient, conjugate of a sum here and a conjugate of a difference. Well, I know from the previous little table that I showed you, I can break this up to be sums of conjugates and differences of conjugates. Okay. So the top bit will become z bar plus I bar all over z bar minus I bar. Okay, well, I can keep simplifying here. What's the conjugate of I? Well, it's negative I. And so I can replace I bar with negative I there and I bar with negative I there. So on the top, I'm going to get z bar minus I, and on the bottom, z bar plus I. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this all over essentially one denominator. Okay, so let me move on to another page. Okay, so what I can do is cross multiply here. Okay, now in the denominator, this is going to multiply with this, but actually I'm going to put this back in this term because then I'm multiplying something with its conjugate. And I know from that previous properties of the previous slide that a complex number times its conjugate is always a real number. Okay, so this will, I'll write that as this now. Okay, and on the top, well, it's going to be basically this whole thing multiplied with this plus this whole thing multiplied with this. So let's work through that. So I'm going to get z bar times z. So that's going to be real, I know that. And I'm going to get I times I. I squared, remember, is negative 1. So the real part of this first thing is going to be this. And then we're going to get I times z and I times z bar. So if I factor out the I, I'll get this. All right, so let's do the same with this times this now. Okay, so z times z bar, again, that's going to be a real. And negative I times negative I. Okay, so if I squared is negative 1, well, that's just, again, going to be negative 1 there, because the two minus signs will cancel. And negative I times z bar, negative I times z, if I factor out the I there, I'll get this. Well, the negative I, I'll get this. Okay, so it's looking a bit messy, but if you have a look closely, you're going to see that some of these things are going to cancel. In particular, all the I's will cancel in the denominator. Okay, so I can, if I want to, I can just cross them off. And we're going to have two lots of this. And remember that z times z bar is the modulus of z squared. So that half will cancel with the two lots of that. And I'll get this thing down here. And now I can use the properties, the relationship between a complex number, its conjugate, and the modulus that I showed you. So this now is going to be the square of the modulus of z. And the bottom is going to be this. Okay, so now what? We spent a lot of time using the properties of the conjugate and the modulus there. Let's go back to what our assumptions were. We're told that if the modulus of z is 1, then show you this thing 0. Well, we've got this here, and if the modulus of z is 1, then the square of the modulus is also 1, right? So this denominator has got to be 0. Right? Okay. So what have we done? We've shown then that the real part of this quotient here, under this notation here, is 0. Okay, so we're pretty happy about that. So let's write that down. Hence, the real part of this is 0. We're really happy. All right. So that, why is that a good example? Because essentially we used a lot of properties from both the modulus and the conjugate to get where we wanted to go. Okay, so that's a good example of using all or a lot of the of those properties to sort of remind you of them and get you using them in your mathematics. Okay, so that's my presentation. I hope you enjoyed it. In forthcoming presentations, we're going to talk about a new way of writing complex numbers through what's known as a polar form. And we'll talk about, you know, the polar trig form and the polar exponential form. So I hope you can join me for those presentations. If you have any comments, any questions, you can always put them in the comment section below. So thanks for watching. Hope to see you soon. Bye.